Does everyone please stand this morning?
Silver or gold, you know that you would never feel the fire or shiver in the cold. But I did say you never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your home. Said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or the loneliness was something you never have to fight. But I did say I'd be right there by your side, and I did say I'll always help you fight. 'Cause you know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. My love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is the promise I made to you. I never said that friends would never turn their backs on you, nor that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise.
I didn't say you never taste the bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. And I did say I'll dry every tear you've cried.
'Cause you know you'll see me face to face, and you'll sing with the angels and a countless multitude. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. So just keep on walking. Don't turn to the left or right. Midst of darkness, let this be your light. That hell can't separate us, and you're gonna make it through. This is the
This is the promise I've made to you. Oh, this is the promise. This is the promise I've made to you.
Why don't we open service with prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this wonderful lady that we're going to talk about today. And thank you for this family, all these friends, this church that's gathered here today. We need your help, Lord. Our hearts are hurting. We Christians weep with them that weep. And we rejoice with them that rejoice. And we just pray your comfort of the Holy Ghost would be here with this dear family and all of us. Let everything be said. Be a help to their hearts. We thank you for it all in the name of your dear son, Jesus. Amen and amen. Wow. That was the kind of singing that Sister Patricia liked right there. That was the kind of singing she done when she sung. My heart is... I don't know whether to cry or shout. Really, my heart is just kind of torn between them emotions that we have because another soldier has laid her armor down. And we're here and still in the arena, but Sister Patricia was an encourager to all of us. If you knew her, she was an encourager. Patricia Gladys Clark, age 90 of Blanchard, went to her heavenly reward on Friday, April 26, 2024. She was the daughter of Clarence and Norma Bell Nixon. She was born August 3, 1933, in Blanchard. Patricia married the love of her life, Wayne Clark, on June 5, 1954, in Wichita, Kansas. They lived in Wichita for 17 years before she returned to Blanchard in 1971. They celebrated 55 wonderful years together until his death in 2010. She was a loving, devoted wife, mother, grandmother, and friend. She worked at the Act II consignment store in Blanchard for 36 years. She was awarded Employee of the Month by the Blanchard Chamber of Commerce. She was, now this is an understatement, she was a faithful member of the Trinity Holiness Church in Blanchard, Oklahoma. She was saved at age 15 and spent the remainder of her life working in the ministry. As a young girl, she evangelized and preached the gospel. She spent many years working in the jail ministry in Chickasha. She also worked in the Jesus House ministry, which evolved into a homeless outreach here at Trinity Holiness Church in Blanchard. She was known as a prayer warrior. That's an understatement. And I got to talk about that in a minute. And she was a woman of great faith. That's an understatement. I'm critiquing this obituary in a good way. She was preceded in death by her parents and her husband, Wayne Clark, grandson, Brantley Knapp, son-in-law, Reverend Dennis Knapp, brothers, R.L. Sullivan, Clarence Bo Nixon, sisters Betty Jo Thurman, Billy Nixon, and Bonnie Terrell. She is survived by her daughters Jeanette Clark, Cheryl Clark, Kim Clark, Karen Clark, all of Blanchard, a daughter Pam Knapp of Prim, Arkansas, granddaughter Christy Brown, and husband Ryan of Prim, grandson Bryce Knapp, and wife Emily of Prim, great grandchildren Shayla Levi and Shayna Brown, Colin, Mila, and Millie Knapp of Prim, Arkansas, and many other relatives and friends. And a special thanks from this family to Complete Hospice Care, especially Kirsten, Liz, Dawn, and Anna, for the excellent care and concern they provided to their mother during her final hours on this earth. the last several days, I've had that flood of memories that you have, reflecting back on the years with Sister Patricia. And of course, you can't say Sister Patricia without thinking of dear brother Wayne Clark, one of the best friends I ever had. Now, I received instruction from my superintendent this morning to not talk about brother Wayne and me, but to talk about Sister Patricia. So I'm not going to tell you who my superintendent is, but she's here, so I've got to try to do what she said. But all of my memories of Sister Patricia run with brother Wayne and these five girls here. I just can't separate them. And Sister Patricia, many times I've been in her home, they've been in our home, we've laughed and cried and joked and prayed and shouted and all the things that you do in a lifetime of memories. I've been in Act 2. She was having specials, and so she'd tell Wayne, tell brothers, so I'd go buy jeans. Sister Patricia was a sales lady, let me tell you. I vacationed with her and Brother Wayne. We took trips to camp meeting. Here's one thing I can honestly say about Sister Patricia. She was the same anywhere you saw her. It did not matter if it was in Act 2, she was a Christian. It didn't matter if you come to her home, she was a Christian. Anywhere you saw her, she was the same. A fine example of what a Christian should be. One thing I read to you from the obituary that I want to just elaborate on just a few minutes. I feel it in my heart that it would not be right if I didn't elaborate on just one thing a while this morning. And she was known as a prayer warrior. Well, that needs a little more added to it. Not only was she known as a prayer warrior, she was a prayer warrior. And the prayers of Sister Patricia Clark, oh Lord, only He knows how many of them reached heaven. Is anybody here besides me that could, with conscience, raise your hand and say that you know for a fact that this lady prayed for you and the prayer went through? I want you to look at the hands. There's at least 30 of us at least right here that in just this one building that I know for a fact, Sister Patricia prayed. You know, in Revelation it says, and John said that this is when Jesus takes the book from the Father, and when He had opened the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of saints. Prayers of saints. And then John also saw again in chapter 8 of Revelation and verse number 3, and another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne, and the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hands. My theology is probably not right here, Brother Lindell, so you pray for me if it's not. But I just wondered how many angels were assigned to Sister Patricia's prayers. And every morning when they started their day, they looked at each other and said, "She's awake. She's fixing to start praying. We're fixing to have to go to work here. She's fixing to pray." And the prayers of the saints were preserved and kept by those angels. David said that my tears are bottled up. So I don't have any more sense to believe what the Bible says, that every tear that Sister Patricia shed, every prayer that she prayed, God stored that. And when the time came, they ascended up before Oh, thank God for the prayers that Sister Patricia prayed for us. Where would we be? Only God knows. Thank you, Lord. When Brother Wayne and I worked together, and we were just, you know, I didn't want to work much, and he didn't want to work much, so we couldn't stay in the race. And so, you know, our work would get down to where we only had one job going, and I'd say, Brother Wayne, have Sister Patricia pray. And she'd start praying, and a day or two later, I'd tell him, have her to quit praying. I've got more houses than I can do. When Sister Patricia prayed, things happened. Amen. And I am so grateful that in my life, I have been able to have met such a wonderful lady and to be able to say something on her behalf today. Lord, have mercy. She prayed. What a thing to be remembered by. My mother prayed. My sister prayed. May God bless you girls today and all of this family and all of you in Jesus' name.
I'm looking for the day when I see Jesus, and his blessed face I shall behold. With the saints of old, the half will then be told, when my feet touch the streets of gold. When my feet touch the streets of glory, when I travel my last weary mile, oh, will he hold my trembling hand when before the bar I stand? Will he say, my child, well done, crown of life you now have won? When my feet touch the streets of gold, on some happy morning you should miss me. Don't you weep for me because I'm gone. I'll be at the feet of the one who died for me. When my feet touch the streets of gold, oh, when my feet touch the streets of glory, when I travel my last weary mile, oh, will he hold my trembling hand when before the bar I stand? Will he say, my child, well done, crown of life you now have won? When my feet touch the street of gold, oh, when my feet touch the street of glory, when I travel my last weary mile, oh, will he hold my trembling hand when before the bar I stand? Will he say, my child, well done, crown of life you now have won? When my feet touch the streets of gold, oh, on some happy morning you should miss me. Don't you weep for me because I'm gone. Well, I'll be at the feet of the one who died for me. When my feet touch the streets of gold, oh, when my feet touch the street of glory, when I travel my last weary mile, Lord, will you hold my trembling hand when before the bar I stand? Will he say, my child, well done, crown of life you now have won? When my feet touch the streets of gold, oh, when my feet touch the streets of glory, when I travel my last weary mile, oh, will he hold my trembling hand when before the bar I stand? Will he say, my child, well done, crown of life you now have won? When my feet touch the streets of gold.
Praise God. Well, you believe that today? I don't believe in soul sleep. I believe to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I believe that if Elijah and Moses really came to Jesus and talked to him on the Mount of Transfiguration, they had to be alive. The Bible said God is not a God of the dead, but a God of the living. So I believe today that Sister Patricia is alive more now than she's ever been. And can you imagine what that little feisty woman did when her feet touched the streets of gold? Hallelujah. That one that lived all of her days to be with her Lord. That one that longed to go to that city where there'll never be another tear, where there'll never be another heartache, where she'll never have to pray another prayer. I can just imagine as she entered into the city limits of heaven, what kind of spell she had there. I'm telling you, it's real today. It's real. Hallelujah. I feel the presence of the Lord right here tonight. Today, as we're here, very appropriate. Thank God. I tell you, it's just wonderful to be a part of this service here today. And I am at a disadvantage of the majority of you of not having had the close relationship with Sister Patricia for all the years that you did. But it has been a great honor to pastor her for the last probably 18 months or so, and her family, get to know them. And having pastored her for these last few months, I can say that I have been inspired to believe God more. I have been inspired to be a better Christian. I've been inspired many times by her. Sister Patricia was, and I'm not going to say a lot here. I got the graveside, so I'm going to get out of the way and let Brother Lindell come as her pastor for many, many years. I know he's got a lot he wants to say, and I look forward to hearing that. But she was a special person with a special calling. She really was. She loved God. She loved people. She loved church. She loved the ministry. She loved the Word of God. She loved preaching. She loved praying. She loved God's house. If she was at all able, she was going to be at God's house. There's been a few times that they come in, and I could just pretty much see it on Sister Jeanette's face. We don't need to be here, but we're here. We're here anyway. And, you know, and I'm telling you, Sister Patricia, she would, you know, she'd get to testifying. And she just couldn't hardly keep her seat now. She just couldn't hardly stay between those pews. And she'd get out, and I'd see Sister Jeanette had to, Sister Jeanette's faith was really strengthened through Sister Patricia the last few years, because Sister Patricia would get out from them pews, and she'd come down that aisle, and she prided herself in not having to use a walker or a cane. And fortunately, she never got humbled by that or had to take that back. She was able to pretty much all the way to the end, maybe just the last few days. But she had come down that aisle, and the Spirit of God and the power of God would be on her. And I'll tell you what, just, you know, you could have a service that might not be going too high and a lot going on, and she could stand to her feet. And there was something about the anointing that she had. She could change the atmosphere of a service by just getting up and just starting to testify and talk about God and talk about the things of God. She could rally a congregation, and she wasn't a promotional speaker or, you know, or anything like that. She was worshiping God. That's what she did. And her worship was so real, it was so genuine, it was so powerful that it would just cause people to stand to their feet and to just throw their hands in the air and just to worship God. And it's just been a highlight of my ministry, of our ministry, my family's ministry here, to just be able to be with her and to sit with her and talk to her and see God use her. And, you know, just the confidence that she had in God. She had a confidence that's not found every day. She had a confidence in God that was rare. And she just believed God. She'd look at me and she'd say, "Brother David, God's going to do it." "Oh, yeah, 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 he's going to take care of it. Oh, it ain't no big deal. He's going to take care of it. You don't have to worry about it." Yeah. I mean, that's the way she talked about it. It wasn't no, you know, and the girls would tell me, said the tornadoes had come, and they had up the videos and was tracking the tornadoes. And she'd say, "That ain't faith. I'm going to bed." And she'd go to bed. She didn't worry about it. And she lived 90 years old. Might be a lesson to all of us around here. And, you know, and you know, she just had that confidence in God. She was genuine. She was real. She was sincere. She was consecrated. And she walked with God every day. Every day she walked with God. And she was such an encourager, you know, just always speaking a word of encouragement and of just trying to lift you up and to help you. And she's going to be so greatly missed, so greatly missed. And, you know, I've said this before, and I say it to this family again today. You're very, very blessed in 2024 to have had a mother and a grandmother like this. This was an old-fashioned, God-fearing, God-seeking woman that believed God and walked with God. And she impacted all of our lives. She impacted more lives than what anybody here probably even can fathom. The lives that she impacted and just the weight that she carried for people. And she was just one of those special people. And I tell you, we're just have been blessed today. And she's going to be missed here at Blanchard. The Blanchard Church has been greatly blessed by her just being a part of this church and just being an encourager and a pusher and just always ready to rally the troops and to push forward. So we're going to miss her greatly, but we wouldn't call her back. We wouldn't call her back. We believe God's had his way and she got what she wanted. And so we're just today rejoicing in the fact that of the life that she lived. And I know there's going to be grief. They're going to miss her. But I tell you what, I thought of that scripture the other day where David's child died and he said he can't come back, but I can go to him. And I tell you what we can do today. Every one of us, 100% of us in this building can go to her. If we'll make up our mind, we can be with her. May the Lord bless you.
When we think of parting, we think of forever. It seems like we never see our loved ones again. But if we live faithful, we have this assurance. There'll be a glad meeting at our journey's end. There'll be a reunion in heaven, I'm sure. On the streets of that city, by the river so pure, there'll be such rejoicing at the end of our way. In that great reunion in heaven someday, when we enter heaven and see all its beauties, we'll see all saints that were faithful and true. Oh, what a great number there'll be up in heaven. I sure plan to be there, so won't you come too? There'll be a reunion in heaven, I'm sure. On the streets streets of that city, by the river so pure, there'll be such rejoicing at the end of our way, in that great reunion in heaven someday. In that great reunion in heaven someday.
I can stand before you today and tell you without any hesitation, one of the greatest ladies I've ever known in this world, Sister Patricia Clark. And I've known some great ones, I really have, but she's at the top of the list. And I pastored her for 27 and a half years. I think I know her pretty well. Can I get this out? Go a long ways back with this lady before I was even born. Sister Patricia was a girl here in the church at Blanchard when my grandfather was a pastor. And she and my mother were dear friends even back in that day. And I've heard Sister Patricia talk about it many times. And my mom didn't talk about it too much. My dad might not would have cared to hear this. But Sister Patricia said that two good-looking boys came from, was it California? California. I don't even know who they was. But two good-looking boys. She remembered that part of it. And she said they had a revival here at this church. It was amazing. I don't know how many young people got saved. And her and my mother was two that got saved during that revival. And she said after the boys began to leave, somebody said, now, Patricia and Fern said their religion, they had boy religion and it won't last. But she had praised God and said it's lasted all these years. So that's kind of our connection back with my mother and Sister Patricia. And then later on, of course, Sister Patricia married Brother Wayne. They moved to his home there in Wichita, Kansas. But I can't remember exactly when it was. You girls would. Some of these girls about my age, Cheryl's somewhat older than me. It's 2 months. But anyway, they came, and man, I'm telling you what, it was amazing. Of course, Sister Patricia had been raised in this church, she had been, Sister Patricia wasn't the only one around here like this. There was a group of them. Said, Shirley, there you are. There's a whole group of ladies around here. I got a few names here I want to read off to you. Sister Cresswell, she lived right across the street here. She didn't have to drive. She just walked. Mother Harmon, Sister Minnie Mitchison, Sister Nixon, of course, Sister Patricia's mother, Sister Marie Jones, and then later on, Sister Dode Lewis, Sister Boutwell, and Mr. Poole. I saw him somewhere back here. His mom and dad was in that group, but these ladies, I'm telling you, they knew how to pray. They believed in prayer. And they would pray 5 days a week. Have you ever saw a church where the ladies met 5 days a week except Saturday and Sunday? Have you ever saw? I never have. I've been in a lot of churches. But 5 days a week, this group of ladies came. And I'll just have to tell you, when I first started pastoring this church, I'd only been preaching 6 months. I didn't know anything. But these ladies prayed and carried us through. And if we had any success, that's where I point to, was these wonderful ladies that God used down through the years. They prayed and prayed and prayed. But Sister Patricia was among that group of ladies, and God used her in such a wonderful way. And as already been mentioned, Sister Patricia, she was a lady of faith. One of the things I remember in particular was I never saw anybody do this, but they're just poor folks. I'm telling you, these five girls were just raised poor. Their dad was a diabetic and had a hard time working, and Sister Patricia just prayed it through. She really did, Pam. No other explanation, but I remember one time her old hens that she used, for eggs. She needed eggs, and her old hen, just her hens got down and was they in molt? Is that what you call it? I'm not much of a farmer, but I think they called it in moat, where they lose their feathers and all of that, and they quit laying eggs.
Well, you know what Sister Patricia done? She just got the bottle of oil that she used to anoint everything else. Went down there and anointed them old chickens. And she said the feathers came back on them. They started laying eggs again. That's the kind of lady she was. She was a woman of faith. Amen. She lived her faith. She prayed her faith. She believed in her faith. And she carried it on right here in this church. And so that's the way I grew up around Sister Patricia and these dear ladies of faith that God used in such a great way. And then I was about 14, 15 years old, a real age where you can go either way. And there was a guy from Arkansas came, and my grandfather had met him, and he had just got saved and just got called to preach. And my grandfather had a real love for this young man because he was from where my grandfather was from, W. George, and he brought him here, and I don't want to offend y'all, but he hadn't hardly been preaching any time. He only had one scripture when he got up. Y'all remember that? Just one scripture. And I'm not sure he didn't just, wherever the Bible fell open, didn't just preach there. I'm not sure about that. But I'm telling you, Sister Patricia took him under her wing. I don't know at that time if she had any premonition that he'd be her son-in-law, but she took him under her wing and just kept on encouraging him and praying for him. And, you know, Brother Dennis really wasn't a great preacher, but he made up for it with all of his antics. He would run and jump. And you know, back then we had banisters in the church, in the old church. And I didn't know the later years why they had those banisters. But I found out, you know, in that time, maybe the 60s or whatever, the ladies' dresses started getting a little bit shorter. They started showing their ankles and all that. So they built banisters. That's the truth, girl. Did y'all know that? That's why we had banisters in the old church, because a lot of the women sat on the stage and they didn't want to see their legs, so they just hit them by them banisters. That's the truth. It really is. And so anyway, old Brother Dennis, he had come flying through there. He was like a cat. He could jump. I've seen him sail over those banisters many a time. And this is God's truth. One night, the service was real high, and Brother Dennis, I looked, he had leaped, and he was on top of the pulpit. He really just stood up there with just his eyes wild, like, what in the world am I doing up here? And I said, well, that's what I was wondering about. It's why he was up there. But, oh, Sister Patricia, she got behind him, and she egged him on, didn't she, Pam? And she'd say, Dennis, I believe God will help you. I'll finish that story. My grandfather saw what he was into, and he'd got a guy there preaching and didn't know how to preach, and Brother Dennis would get one scripture, and he'd preach on it for a while till he ran out. My grandfather, being a man of God by then, and he'd get ahead of him, and he'd say, all right, Brother Dennis, we're going to preach this one now. And I can still see Brother Dennis, all right, Brother W. Reed, and then Grandpa would read the scripture. He'd say, oh, yeah, we'll preach that a while. And then he'd go on with that. Wait, is that right? I'm telling you. But it was wonderful. I never had church like it in my life. It was wonderful. It made such an impression on my young mind. That's probably the reason why that I decided to serve God myself was during that time. And so we would go on. Of course, you know, history tells us what happened. And Brother Dennis fell in love with this young girl, really. 14, is that right? Don't recommend it. Young girls, hide your ears. Don't listen to this. Don't recommend it. But it worked for them, but I wouldn't recommend it. But anyway, Sister Patricia kept on praying for him. God gave Brother Dennis a wonderful ministry. But I really believe that Brother Dennis, if he's alive today, would tell you, one of the successes of my ministry is my mother-in-law just kept on believing and kept on praying for me. Amen. And then as time goes on, of course, I'm a young man. I grow up, and I've been preaching about 6 months in the church here. Puts me in as pastor. And I'm telling you, if you know somebody needs some prayer, I needed some prayer. I was completely out of my league. I didn't know how to pastor. I didn't know how to do much of anything. But this group of ladies got behind me and kept on praying for me, and God began to bless this church. And somewhere along that time, Brother Johnny Taylor sitting back here, we had some clothes that we said we wanted to give to somebody. And Brother Johnny said, you know, I've heard about a homeless ministry up in Oklahoma City called the Jesus House. And he said, I think it'd be a good place. He said, I'd like to go there anyway and just see what it's all about. And we did. Brother Johnny and I and my wife, Cindy, We went to the Jesus house, and we went in there, just an old flop house. It was dirty, dogs running around, and it was nasty. But, you know, we went in there, and somehow God let us know he wanted to do a work in that old Jesus house. And so we started there. They invited us to come in, start having church there. I don't remember how long it was, Brother Johnny, but not long after that, Sister Patricia, being a lover of souls as she is and she was, and she wanted to go with us. Brother Wayne didn't, but she did. And she went with us. And I never saw a lady like her. She just, she had a holy boldness about her. And she'd walk up, some of them was hardened criminals. And she'd walk up to them and just say, "What about your soul? Have you ever known Jesus?" And she had started in on them. They didn't have no choice but to pray. They really didn't, because, you know, she just, that's the way she was. And she began to put down names, church. Before it's over with, the last I knew, she had 1,300 names on her list that she was praying for. That's the kind of lady this lady was. I knew her very well. Oh, what a godly woman she was. I want to read you one scripture here. And I won't hold you a whole lot longer, but in the book of St. Matthew, the ninth chapter and the 36th verse, and Jesus here is speaking, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as a sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he unto his disciples, "The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few." And here's what he said. He said, "Pray ye, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest." I think all of us would agree today, when Jesus found Sister Patricia, he found a laborer in his harvest. She took it to heart. That's what, that really seemed like all that mattered to her, really, was to serve the Lord, see another soul won for Jesus. And I appreciate that very much. But one of the greatest things, I want to close with this today, one of the greatest things I ever saw under Sister Patricia was right here in this church. As already been mentioned, Sister Patricia had went to work for the used clothing store down here. And I'm sure, you know, they needed money, I'm sure. But I really think the main reason she wanted to be out in the public where she could deal with souls, I believe that's a real reason that she worked that job, and it was a wonderful opportunity. And I'd hear her from time to time tell about folks she was talking to about their soul. But one, I believe it was on a Wednesday night, we came here and started church back in that day. I don't know how you do it now, but back in that day, we'd have song service, then we'd have prayer request. And Sister Patricia stood right up over on the side right here, and she said, "Y'all, I want you to help me pray about something." She said, "I was down at the used clothing store, and there's a man been coming in there. He's lost, and I've been talking to him about his soul." In fact, she said, the other day, I was in the clothing store, and this man walked in. She said, "There was a lot of other people there, but I felt like God wanted me to deal with him specifically that day about his soul." And here's what she said. She said, "I prayed and said, 'Lord, well, there's so many people in here. Would you let everybody clear out except for Bobby Hall?'" That was his name. And she said, "I looked around. Everybody was gone except Bobby Hall." And she, all this is going on, it's more like a testimony than a prayer request. But anyway, she said, "Bobby, I want to talk to you today about your soul and about Jesus." And before she got through, here's what she told us. She said, "When I got through, I said, 'Bobby, why don't you come down to our church on the corner and come to church with us?'" And before she sat down, here's what she said. She said, "I believe he's coming. God is my witness." She sat down. A few minutes later, that back door opened up and he walked in. And that's really what happened. And he walked in, and I hope nobody's offended by what I say here, but he is one of the most gruesome men I've ever saw. He and his son had gotten in some kind of a skirmish, and his son had shot him and shot off just about half of his face. And it was a gruesome sight. I don't mean that disrespectfully. I love everybody, but that's the way it really was. And Bobby walked in that night, sat down, And I don't think that night he prayed, but he kept on coming. And one night he walked down to the altar here on this side. And here again, not trying to be disrespectful, but I walked down to pray with him. Several of us did. But his smell was so bad that I picked up a Kleenex and held it over my nose as I prayed for him. It was horrible. It really was. And he was, I don't think he was homeless, but he was very, very bad shape and lived by himself and just a vagabond, you might say. But God began to deal with him. And Sister Patricia, I'm telling you, she just got on that feller and started talking to him about getting saved and giving his heart to the Lord. And God really did save that man. It was amazing. He just kept on coming, just kept on coming. And one night, just about the time I was fixing to walk up to this pulpit, or not this one, the one back then, and preach, I looked out of the corner of my eye, and Bobby stood up. I thought, well, he's probably needing prayer. He didn't stop at the altar. He took an old pair of glasses out of his pocket, and he pulled out a piece of paper out of his pocket, and he walked up behind the pulpit. And as he walked up, I was standing here. He said, I believe I'll sing one tonight. And y'all, I'm sorry, my faith wasn't very good. And I thought, well, Lord, have mercy. You can't hardly talk. How can you sing? And, you know, his mouth was so deformed. But anyway, in a real high voice, there was another man we'd been bringing to church from the old Jesus house, and his mother wrote songs. I didn't know it, but Bobby had got a hold to the words to this song. And he began to sing in a very high voice, I'm glad Jesus found me, and he brought me on in. I was tired of the world and the wages of sin. With his own precious blood, he has made me his own. Now I'm headed for heaven, my heavenly home. None of us knew it here, but that man had a short time to live. You know, God knows how to deal with folks. I really believe God knew when he walked in that little clothing store. He knew that Sister Patricia would talk to him and he'd have a chance to be saved. Oh, that's what Sister Patricia lived for, somebody else to be saved. And that's what happened. Not long after that, we found out that Bobby was in the hospital. We didn't realize it, but there was a tumor that was forming behind. He just had one eye that was just barely still in the socket. And behind that eye, there was a tumor that was forming. Didn't know that. And he was a man with cancer. He was in the hospital. We went to visit him. And then later on, somebody called me and said they put him in a little rest home over here at Chickasha. And Sister Patricia just kept on praying for him. Thank God he's got saved. You know how she'd do. And I believe God's going to take him to heaven. That's what she'd say it. So me and Brother Johnny, we went over to the little rest home there. Never forget it. One of the greatest things that ever happened in my life. And it was all because of Sister Patricia. We walked in that little rest home. Brother Johnny, you'll remember this well. We walked in. He was just laying there. But this time, the one eye that was almost out, it was completely dim by then. And just had one eye looking straight up. We walked in. I tried to talk to him a little bit. He didn't say a word. I just said, Bobby, we're glad you've been coming to our church. We're glad you got saved. And anyway, we stood there a little bit. And just I said, well, Brother Johnny, let's sing Amazing Grace. And we did. Got through singing Amazing Grace, fixing to step out of the room. And I saw his lips begin to move. And I thought, well, I wonder what he, you know, I've been preaching a long time. And a lot of time, folks at the end of life want to say something to the preacher. I thought, well, that's what he wants to do. And I walked over to the bedside, and I leaned down real close to try to see what he was saying. And I realized he wasn't talking. He was singing, I'm glad Jesus found me, and he brought me on in. That's what he was singing right there in that little rest home. And I'm telling you, it was all because of this lady laying right here that I believe is in heaven right now. I've already thought about that. I wonder when Sister Patricia saw the other side. If it's this way, I'm not sure how it is. Amen. I'm like Brother David. I believe she and he also are in the presence of God. I wonder if they met up again. I wonder if you said to her, Sister Patricia, thank you for telling me about Jesus. Thank you for inviting me to the house of God. I'm in heaven now. Oh, what a great lady. What a great lady. But my thought is this morning in closing, where are we going to find another Sister Patricia at? I'm not down on the young people. I'm not down on anybody. But where are we going to find another Sister Patricia? We need them so bad in this hour we're living in. Surely the Lord is looking down from heaven and saying, pray ye the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into the vineyard. We need some more Sister Patricias. And I like this song. My grandson actually sings it. And here's the words. Who's going to tell them that Jesus loves them? Who's going to tell them there's a better way? Who's going to tell them of the things coming on them so they can turn their night to day? Would you pray with me that God will raise up other young folks now? I believe that's what Sister Patricia would want us to do. Raise up another generation like her that loves Jesus, loves souls, wants folks to be saved. I really believe that's what we ought to pray for this morning. I appreciate everyone. Appreciate so much knowing Sister Patricia and her family. One of the last things she said to me last Wednesday, actually, when we was there in her church, was she said, I miss Fern so bad. She said, I miss the times that we got to talk on the phone. I believe they joined back together again, and I'm so thankful there's a place where our loved ones can go, and I believe she's there this morning. God bless you.
Surveyed all the good things that comes to me from above, if I could count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal king. I'm sure he'd grant it again and again. I wanna stroll over heaven with you some glad day when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away, and we'll enjoy all the beauty where all I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come that morning of rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I wanna stroll over heaven with you some glad day when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away, and we'll enjoy all the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. We'll renew old acquaintance with friends we once knew, and we'll see all our loved ones, and we'll see Jesus too. That will be a glad reunion, and there'll be so much.
God's throne over heaven with you.
Sorry, I'm supposed to lead y'all in the congregation here. Will you meet me over yonder? Let's all stand together if you would. I am bound for that bright city where the streets are paved with gold, where in peace I'll dwell forever. Oh, the joy can ne'er be told. Will you meet me over yonder, and with happy million dwell? Will you meet me over yonder, where we'll ever say farewell? Oh, that will be a happy meeting with that dear once passed away. Oh, the joy of that reunion in that land of perfect day. Oh, will you meet me over yonder, and with happy men dwell? Will you meet me over yonder, where we'll never say farewell? Oh, brother, say, how are you living? Should he call for you to go? Are you ready for the summons? In a robe made white as snow. Oh, will you meet me over yonder, and with happy million dwell? Oh, will you meet me over yonder, where we'll never say farewell? Oh, there a mansion is awaiting for the ones who've overcome. Soon life's storms will pass forever, and we'll safely reach our home. Oh, will you be singing, church, over yonder, and with happy million dwell? Oh, will you meet me over yonder, where we'll ever say farewell? Oh, will you meet me over, and with high, help me sing it, come on. Oh, will you meet me over yonder, where we'll never say farewell? Well, there a man, John, in the waiting for the ones who've overcome. Oh, let's worship him this morning in memory of Sister Patricia. And we'll safely reach our homes. Oh, when he meet me over yonder. Woo, hallelujah, red high, in million dwell. Will you meet me over yonder, where we'll never say farewell? Brother, say,
How are you living? Should it call for you to go? Are you ready for that summons in your robe made of white snow? Oh,
will you meet me on yonder? And with a happy feeling swell,
oh,
will you meet me on yonder?
Where will
never sink or well?
I am bound for that black city where the streets are paved with gold, where in peace I'll dwell forever. Oh, yes. Oh, the joy.
Oh, the joy.
There be told. Oh, think about it, in a wedding for the ones who've overcome. Soon life's storms will pass forever, and we'll say we meet our goal. Oh, will you meet me over yonder? I'll just lift our hands of praise in this morning. I'm not surprised this good spirit's here. That's the way Sister Patricia would want it. She'd want us to worship God. That's where she lived. She loved it. Amen. I'm so glad for this wonderful spirit we have right now. I want to say one more word. There's a man here I haven't saw in many years, but he was back here in that day. Leland Clark, I'm glad to see you today here, son. Man, so long ago. But you remember the old church, I know you do. You helped a revival here. And so God bless every one of you today is my prayer.
Somewhere just across the Jordan River is a place of everlasting joy and peace, where the tree of life is blooming there forever. And the crown of life is waiting there for me.
The
the crystal river flows by the tree of life. No pain, no disappointments there will hurt us. And Jesus Christ himself will be the light.
Till my home to me, right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with the story as we sing his grace and glory. God will be. That sounds like home to me. That sounds like home to me. Right where I want to be. There'll be no tears to fill our eyes again. The hills will echo with the story as we sing his grace and glory, where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home to me. Where the saints of God will be. That sounds like home.
If I could count the tears that have fallen, it would seem like an ocean to me. And if my heart was a window you could look through, know the pain and the scars you would see.
Tears will never shed that city. No risk our death on my mansion's door. Teardrops are welcome beyond the gates of glory.
The lost of a loved one. The grave seems so final and so cold. Oh, we'll meet again where death has no victory. In a land where we'll never grow old.
Tears will never stay
the streets of that city.
No rays of death
Been on my way to heaven for such a long, long time, and many things have happened that's clouded up my mind, but I am more determined to walk the narrow way. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday.
The golden streets to walk upon, a bell I'm gonna ring, a brand new angel in the choir, I wanna hear her
There'll be a lot of friends awaiting
when I walk through the gate.
I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. Been through lonesome valleys, I've climbed the highest hills. I've known the joy of living in the center of God's will. I've watched the angels come and take my loved ones home to stay. And I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday.
There's a golden street to walk upon, a bell I'm gonna ring, a brand new angel in the choir, I wanna hear her sing.
There'll be a lot of friends awaiting
as I walk through the gates.
I've got more go to heaven for than I had yesterday. Going through lonesome valleys, I've climbed the highest hills. I've known the joy of living in the center of God's will. I've watched the angels come and take my loved ones home to stay. And I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday.
There's a golden street to walk upon, a bell I'm gonna ring, a brand new angel in the choir, I wanna hear her sing.
There'll be a lot of friends awaiting
when I walk through the gate.
Yesterday,
there's a golden street.